Okay, so I'd like to start with a little disclosure. I really don't study sports much or at all, but did my best to make the link to sports and some of the things that we're doing. And I think sports are very important, and I'll talk a little bit about that and how we sort of get close to sports with some of our work. Okay, so first off, of course, I'm going to present the work of a large team of people. This is our core group. We call ourselves the VA Minneapolis Adaptive Design and Engineering Program. So we really languished over this for a long time. So one thing is, if you work for the government, you like acronyms, so you have to use acronyms. And then if you want an acronym that sort of encapsulates what you do, and I think this does. We really try to make things. We do some science, but we're really engineers trying to develop new technologies. I also talk a little bit about most of the folks here are engineers, but there's also a rehab physician. There's a research nurse. We have study coordinators with different backgrounds. And we have a machinist on site that can make almost anything we ask him to make. So quite a good team of folks. We also can't do this work without funding. And we get a lot of our funding from the VA, which has an intramural funding program. And then we get a significant amount as well from the Department of Defense and some of these other agencies as well. So first off, I want to tell you a little bit about Minneapolis VA. This is a picture of our largest building, which we refer to as Building 70. So that means there were 69 other buildings on this site before this building, some still standing, some not standing anymore. And now I think we're up to probably about Building 80 or so. So continuously a lot of activity at this site. There's also a lot of rehab activity, clinical rehab activity. We're one of seven regional amputation centers in the VA, one of five polytrauma rehab centers, and one of 25 spinal cord injuries and disorders center. So we really have a ton of clinical rehab activity, and there's a lot of interest in research, and really we're sort of growing the research at the moment. Now, I would point to the picture. There's a little river in the back there. Does anyone know which river this is? Just shout it out. Who knows what river goes through Minneapolis? So it happens to be the Mississippi River. So up where we're at, the Mississippi River is quite small. If you get to the south, it gets quite big, as you know. But it starts in the north of Minnesota, works its way through Minneapolis, St. Paul, and of course all the way down to New Orleans. So a quick outline. I'm going to talk primarily about lower limb prosthetics and wheelchairs and some different designs that we've worked on. I'm also going to talk a little bit about a piece of exercise equipment we worked on, and I'll talk about a head support system for dropped head syndrome. So I would say that as an engineer, I've learned a lot about how to solve problems, but I'll tell you I'm not the best at identifying problems. And in the medical field, the people who are best at identifying problems are clinicians who are seeing patients on a day-to-day basis. So a lot of our technologies really started with clinicians telling us, hey, we need something to solve this issue, and then we start collaborating with them and working on these different designs. Really, there's sort of an overarching goal of our work, and it really stems from this international classification of functioning, disability, and health. It's referred to often as the ICF model, and really what we're focusing on is trying to maximize participation of veterans with disabilities in their life roles, so in their family roles, social, work, and leisure activities, which would include sports. So first I'll start out with an ankle design we call the bimodal ankle-foot system. And this is primarily geared toward veterans with lower limb amputations who are really sort of on the lower functioning side of things. They probably had their amputation due to peripheral vascular disease or diabetes, and they may have sensation loss on the remaining foot and on their residual limb. So a lot of these folks have low balance confidence, and there's literature that really connects low balance confidence with reduced social activities and reduced mobility. So if you really don't believe you're going to be able to maintain your balance, a lot of times you'll say, just go ahead without me, I'll stay here. And so that's what we want to get over that. We want to somehow fix that. And another thing we know is that lower limb amputees fall very frequently, much more frequently than the elderly population. And honestly, we don't know what they're doing when they fall. So we've tried several proposals. We'll keep trying until we get funded, but we want to understand what are people doing when they actually have an injurious fall or a fall that changes their confidence. So these are the worst falls. If you fall, you get up, you keep going, you're not hurt, it doesn't affect your life. It's okay. You know, who cares about that fall? So we really want to understand the falls that both injure you, cause medical expenses, but also reduce your confidence and take you out of participation. So, but unfortunately, I can't talk about that yet because we don't know the answer. But if anyone else knows, please tell me what it is. So one approach we think is that new prosthesis products may be able to improve stability for prosthesis users and really help them get out and do things. So this is some data from time I was at Northwestern University. We were looking at what's the effective role of the foot and ankle in general, right? So for walking, what is it actually doing? So we know it's amazingly complex. There's a lot of bones and muscles and tendons and et cetera, et cetera. But what is it doing as a whole? And what we found is a way to measure sort of what's the effective rocker shape that this thing creates. And what we found is that for walking, it makes sort of a circular rocker shape. And so when I say rocker, it's very much like the rocking of a rocking chair. So you're basically rolling from one foot to the next over these pretty circular sort of rocker shapes. And part of my PhD was looking at how do those shapes change if we walk faster or slower? What happens if we carry added weights? So often we'll just throw on a backpack and start walking and think nothing of that. So what are we actually doing now? And what we found is that this shape stays pretty much the same. If you're walking fast, slow, if you're carrying weights, and you even adapt your ankle motion for, let's say, high-heeled shoes to keep this rocker shape the same if you're looking at the ankle-foot shoe. So for walking, you seem to want this sort of curved rocker shape, but what about for other activities? So for standing, if I'm standing here right now, it's rather unexciting, but let's say I start swaying back and forth. Don't jump out of your seats in excitement here, but basically, when you start to do that, you can measure these effective shapes. We actually make very flat effective shape when we're standing and standing and swaying. And so it's very much like the microphone there in the middle of the room. So if we want the microphone to stand on its own, we give it a flat base, stands on its own. If we put a curved base on the microphone stand, falls over, breaks the microphone probably. And he's upset with me at the back probably, right? So we won't do that. So they're basically two very different things that the foot ankle's doing. So this looks at it a little more. So you can measure the curvature of the shapes. The radius of a rocker is, you know, one over the curvature. So the radius for walking is about a sixth of the height. And for swaying, it's approximately equal to your height. So the way to look at that is if this guy's walking, his foot and ankle are creating this sort of circular rocker shape here, and his center of mass is above that. And so that system naturally wants to fall over. So, and of course, a lot of people in the literature have talked about walking as falling from one foot to the next. For standing and swaying, it's different. So the radius is much larger. So now the radius is above the center of mass, and that's an inherently stable system. And so he actually starts to act sort of like this Weeble toy. So I don't know how many people know that. Older people know the Weeble toy. I know the Weeble toy. But Weebles were a toy, and basically the big slogan for Weebles was Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down. And the reason for that is they had a very low center of mass, you know, beneath the radius of this rocker on the bottom. So we were curious about what are current prosthetic feet, what kind of radius do different prosthetic feet have in the market? There are probably 200 to 300 different kinds of prosthetic feet you could buy for a patient right now. There's not a great guidance for how you pick those. But we looked at about 40 feet. This is late 2000, you know, 2008, and found that most seem to be focused on walking function, because most have a radius that's close to what would be ideal for walking, and nobody really is designing for standing. Now, you know, in their defense, if you design a foot for standing, it'd be like the microphone stand base, wouldn't be very good for walking. So usually what people do is they make up for it with the other foot, or they use other motions to try to make up for this discrepancy. But we thought we want to try to actually make a foot that can do both. So what if the ankle were flexible for walking and then could sort of lock up and be not flexible for standing? So it could be much more stable. So this is sort of one of our earlier designs. It's based on a foot ankle design that's over 100 years old, which is a single axis sort of design, but it has a locking feature so that when you're standing, you can lock it and get more stability in standing. And then it does that by a little tiny motor inside, a little actuator that can move the little locking mechanism in and out. And a really key part of this is a spring. The little springs on there, so they'll allow the system to go, the actuator to move the whole distance, even if things aren't aligned, without burning up the actuator. So that's the point of these springs, and then when things move into place, the thing can lock or unlock. And this is a picture of the current design, which we just finished a study of this design in 18 veterans with unilateral below the knee amputation. And what we found is that veterans had better balance with the locked ankle when their eyes were closed compared to the unlocked ankle. And so one thing of note here, and this is from using the same machine that you were describing earlier, but only using the first couple of conditions of this machine. But what you'll notice is that the equilibrium scores are quite high for these patients to start with. So 100 would be perfect, basically perfect balance. And so we had a pretty, you know, a group that had very high balance and actually pretty high balance confidence. So it's not exactly who this is designed for, but this is who we ended up getting in our study. Another thing we looked at is when it's unlocked, how does it compare to their current foot? Is it slowing them down? Is it changing their mobility? And basically walking speed wasn't any different, and the time taken to do what we call an L-test was no different. So the L-test is you're sitting and you stand, you walk 3 meters, you turn to the right, you go 7 meters, and then you come back along the same L shape and sit down. And it's how long does it take you to go through that? And so that really wasn't affected. So this suggests that the mobility really wasn't degraded by our system compared to current prostheses. And then a lot of this, you know, in product design is whether people like something and want to try and use it or not. you know, if we got great data and nobody really liked it or wanted to use it, then that's not great. So we asked people, do you like, you know, after the study was over, it was actually a double blind study, so the patient didn't know which thing they were using, and the person running the machine had no idea which we were in. But afterward, we unblind it and show them what happened, you know, what they were doing. And then we ask these questions. So, do you like the locking feature? 13 out of 18 said yes. Do you feel less balanced, more balanced, or the same? Most people felt the same, actually, but nobody felt less balanced, and quite a few felt more balanced. And would you be interested in trying this for a longer period of time in the future? So our study was an in-lab trial, get used to it for only, you know, 15 minutes or so, and then do some testing. But a lot of people said they would like to try it for a longer period of time. And then we asked, what would they be interested in something that would automatically lock when they're standing and automatically unlock when they're walking? And 15 out of 18 said yes. So that's sort of what we do. When we go from standing to walking, we sort of change the control of our ankle foot system to get a different output. And so that's what this would be trying to do. So, you know, at the same time, we were already developing this automatic feature because we thought nobody's going to want to, you know, every time they start walking, like push a button or, you know, key fob button or something. So we already had started working on a system that used a gyroscope microcontroller, and then it used a mobile app on a phone to say, okay, if I'm now going to stand and give a speech in front of a lot of people, and I want to make sure it stays locked, I can take it out, and I can push lock, and then I can put it back in my pocket, and it'll stay locked. Or if I know I'm going to walk now for many miles, and I don't want this thing to lock on me, I can do this. So we asked people what they think about this idea. And honestly, only one person really liked the idea of a mobile app, which was surprising to us, but that's how it goes. So most people would rather have a button on the prosthesis that they could just reach down and move a switch. So we're working on that now. Other people said we'd really like to have some medial lateral flexibility. So we like this stability, but we'd like it to have a little bit of, you know, medial lateral movement. And so that's that, we can achieve that by adding some, let's see if I can get a, this little orange thing under the forefoot is actually sort of a rubber piece that allows the forefoot to sort of, gives you this flexibility. So in conclusion, long-term testing is really needed with veterans who are struggling with balance and balance confidence. So we actually need to make our study a lot easier than it was. We had, I told you about a few parts, but we had you know, standing still, eyes open, standing still, eyes closed. We did a motor control test, which is the surface you're standing on moves, but we actually had them turn 45 degrees so we could really throw them onto the forefoot or the heel. So there was a lot of testing. And, you know, so we need to really bring that down to a couple of very simple tests. We think improved balance could lead to better confidence and increased participation. We really need to get this sort of thing out into a longer-term study and measure these things. And then one other thing is that the current ankle locks at one angle, which is nice if you're staying on this level stage. But it's not so nice if you're standing on this downhill lie and your golf ball's down the hill. So we have a proposal in now where we can actually, you know, push on the heel and then hit the lock button and then actually be able to stand stably on the downhill to hit the golf ball. So that was my stretch to sports on this particular one. It gets better, so... The next thing I want to talk about is what we call equifoot, adaptable ankle. And this is more addressing problems of higher functioning veterans with lower limb amputations. So, like I said before, a lot of prostheses on the market. Most actually work very well if you walk on nice level terrain. Okay, and there's a lot of level terrain, but there's also a lot of not level terrain. So there are a few prostheses that will adapt to different slopes, but they either have delays, so it may take five steps on a new terrain for the thing to fully adapt. And by that time, you're maybe off that terrain. So with delays, it's a problem, right? Because you're often sometimes walking like this if you're on a hiking trail, right, up and down. So the ankle could be wrong all the time. Other things that are on the market now are using sort of damping control, which damping in itself really reduces, pulls energy out of the system. And for walking, you typically don't want to do that. You want to try to store and release as much energy as possible to try to keep the efficiency of walking up. So we started looking at this by looking sort of at the torque versus angle relationship of the ankle. And what we found is that we could try to mimic this torque-angle relationship with the model that you see on the right. So it's two sets of stiffnesses, basically. You let the foot find the surface and then engage a stiffer spring, store energy, get it back, and then release this stiffer spring so that the other springs can pick the foot up for swing phase so that you don't stub your toe. And so initially this was just sort of looking at data and then exercise and can we make something that's sort of biomimetic that mimics this. But what became clear right away after that was that if we could do this, this thing would automatically adapt to different slopes because it would try to find the surface on a level, might be in plantar flexion angle of, let's say, 10 degrees. And then you go up 5 degrees slope, it might be only 5 degrees now instead. So it would automatically adapt your alignment of the ankle on every step. So that was drawn in my notebook about 13 or 14 years ago. So this is a difficult problem we've been working on for a long time. And up until now, I have said I really want that to be purely mechanical design, no motors, batteries, because a lot of people say, hey, I don't want to plug the battery in. But, you know, times are changing. Everybody, almost everyone in this room, I would guess, is carrying something like this around. They're already plugging in, so I'm starting to relax this a bit. But basically, this was a design that we were able to make work, and it's a load-activated cam clutch system. So it allows the foot to find the surface. When this ring turns red, that ankle part sort of locks up. You're storing energy in this foot plate, and then you get it back. And what's neat about this is you get some plantar flexion beyond neutral during walking, followed by a quick pickup of the foot for swing phase. And you can see this in a sort of slowed down video here. It's a little bit dark, but you can see how this ankle is it's going down a 10 degree slope. Let's go back. He's walking down a 10 degree slope here. Let me see if this will work. Come back in. Dangerous move. Dangerous move. Coming back in. All right. So basically, it's really cool. You need to see this. That's why I'm going to such lengths. Okay, so if we get here, you can see how the foot will find the surface. You store energy in that plate. You get it back, and then the foot picks itself up for swing phase. So does everyone kind of see that? So purely mechanical system, really cool. The thing that's missing is audio on this thing, because when it releases, it does one of these things. So that's great. So people walk with this, they say, hey, feels great. This is nice. It's more comfortable walking on the slopes, takes less effort. We can look at biomechanics data. We can show clearly it's adapting, but that kills the design. Unless you like walking down the street all the time. I haven't found a patient that wants to do that. So anyway, this is sort of the biomechanics stuff. The torque angle, you can show something's adapting if you show the torque angle shifts. So if the torque angle shifts toward dorsiflexion when you go uphill, it's like changing the alignment of the ankle. So it's almost like having a prosthetist riding on the prosthesis and saying, hey, we're going to go uphill on the next step. Let's adjust this, tip the foot up for this uphill. So we've been able to show that. And if you look at the ankle angle curves, you see very close characteristic for different slopes, just shifted into dorsiflexion, plantar flexion for the equifoot, and sort of goofy stuff for the usual prosthesis. So when you watch people walk with usual prosthesis on slopes, it looks uncomfortable because it's not adapting. And this turns out to be something people tell us about a lot. This is the foot we're now studying. It's a sort of a reduced mass version, still has the clicking noise, but has carbon fiber plates, and we're looking at sort of energy efficiency walking with this, as well as the biomechanics part. And this is where I said, I'm sort of like saying, hey, if we did a lightly active design, the mechanics of the thing get really simple. So this is a new design that we've recently received a patent for, but haven't created yet. But basically allows the foot to find the surface. It's using sort of a hydraulic cylinder, spring, some check valves, and then there's a key component here, which is a valve that opens at toe off and closes. So all you really have to do is monitor the toe off event, open this valve, let fluid flow, and then close it again. So the control could be very simple. So of course, when is automatic adaptation to slopes? Does it actually matter? It actually matters. So before I came, I think it was maybe 3 days ago, I talked to one of our prosthetists and he said, hey, there's this new foot out by Oser that sort of gives a little more flexibility. And one of his patients said, when I go to South Dakota, I don't do this certain hike, but I'm doing it now. So that's a powerful thing. So technology really can make a difference. And that system doesn't even exactly adapt. It's just giving a little more flexibility. So we think this could be hopefully getting more people out on the hiking trails and going to parks and places with their family. So this is where I do a sort of sidebar thing on the whole prosthesis thing. So this has come up before. Can we augment human performance using a prosthesis? So if anyone would like to look at more at this, look up someone named Hugh Hare from MIT. Very incredible guy, has done some very neat work. He's done some TED Talks, really interesting stuff. And I'm going to show you some pictures of him actually. But so in my answer to this question is, if you want to make an ankle that can do this for all tasks, I say no. Basically, we're walking around with a Swiss Army knife of function. Okay, so I don't think any of the things our foot ankle does is really super complex. It's just that it does a whole bunch of things. Okay, so for standing, it makes a flat base. For walking, it gives you sort of this curved shape. If you're running, it acts more like a spring. If you're walking on slopes, it changes. So it's tough to make a prosthesis that will do that for all tasks. Now, for certain tasks, I think perhaps, and I'm going to show, yeah, absolutely. So prostheses can give you an advantage. So here's an example I came up with. This would be a really boring sport, but it would be stand on one foot for as long as you can, right? So, you know, most people have tried this. You can go a while, and then it gets pretty tough. If this person had a very comfortable prosthetic socket, and they had a foot that was that big and flat, they could probably outstand you. This was another thing. There was a huge controversy about this.
Of all the battles athletes fight to get to an Olympic Games, none has been greater than those fought by Oscar Pistorius. He is the only athlete here who doesn't just take off his street shoes and put on his track shoes to run. He takes off his street legs and puts on his track legs. They call him...
So one thing I want to point out is that when he walked up to the track, he wasn't walking on these things because they're not very good for walking. And then when he was standing there trying to get these legs out of his bag, he wasn't standing on these either because he very hard to stand on these things. So when you watch runners, Paralympic runners with these feet, if they're standing before getting in the blocks, they're continuously moving their feet because they have very small base of support.
Him, the blade runner. Born with deformed limbs, his running blades may be the most controversial pieces of equipment in sports.
So in running, it's actually pretty good design for running. It's a spring. So there's a big controversy about this particular runner, even before he was found to be a convicted murderer. There was a big controversy. Should this fellow be allowed to run in the Olympic Games with able-bodied people or not? Some said, hey, he has an advantage. He's carrying around less weight because these prostheses weigh a lot less than physiologic legs. They said it can store and release lots of energy. So the other side said, hey, a physiologic ankle-foot system can have a net output of work. These things are passive. They can't do that. So this still remains a controversy and a question. Here's where I say absolutely can be an advantage. So this is Hugh Hare. He's a professor at MIT. He's a rock climber. He lost his legs he was climbing and there was a storm and he had frostbite, lost both legs. But what he started to understand was that he could make his feet be better for climbing than what he had before. So he started cutting the heels off of the feet because he didn't need those. He started cutting the forefoot off because it was just extra stuff. And you can make very sharp things for ice, etc. I encourage you to watch some of his TED Talks. They're quite inspiring. So now I'm going to move on to wheelchairs. So for most of my life, I worked on prostheses. After moving to Minneapolis, I got to know a fellow named Gary Goldish, who at the time was the director of the Spinal Cord Injury Center at the VA. And so I've been working with him since 2009. And so the wheelchairs are really, the rest of what I'll show you is work that I've done with Dr. Goldish. So brief description of current manual wheelchairs. So in manual wheelchairs, the hand rims are connected directly to the drive wheels. The wheels are placed as far forward as possible for the shoulder. So when I was learning about wheelchairs, I went and talked to a therapist and I said, how do you set up a wheelchair? And she said, well, you move this as far forward as possible for the shoulders, but if you go too far, it'll tip over backward. So as an engineer, it's like, oh, we have a That's interesting, right? That's a problem we can try to solve. So the trade-off is that a lot of times people have to reach back to reach the hand rims. And I'd say this is very common in senior wheelchair users. So you may have seen an older person in a wheelchair moving their arms about this far on the hand rim, or not doing that at all and just using their heels to sort of pull themselves along in a wheelchair. So another thing about current wheelchairs is usually that wheel is far enough forward where it's in the way, at least partially in the way for transfers in and out of the wheelchair. So usually you'd set the wheelchair at an angle like this, use a transfer board, and do your best to get into the wheelchair. Another approach is to get right next to it and lift up over but this is putting enormous stress on the shoulders. So another thing is that manual wheelchair users are very highly likely to get shoulder injuries. I think it's 75% or higher get these shoulder injuries. So we had made a design already, but it's a better story if I tell you about this work first, which this work had actually happened roughly at the same time we were making our design. But Sloak and Neptune Neptune is a very well-known biomechanics researcher in Texas. And so their group conducted these four dynamic models of wheelchair propulsion and looking at the upper extremity demand. So they had the models you see here with all these various muscles, and they tested a whole bunch of different hand rim positions of a wheelchair in this model. And they said, not all these seat positions can be achieved in standard wheelchairs, but they wanted to put it in the model to see if this would, to ascertain whether these seat positions would be favorable if stability concerns were overcome by a novel design. So seat position was what they were looking at, you know, leave the hand rim in place and move the seat around, but, you know, just similar, similar idea to say the seat's stable and moving the hand rim around. So what they ended up finding was there was really this sort of minimum here of overall average muscle stress. And this was at a hub to shoulder angle, roughly minus 10 degrees, top dead center elbow angle of 120 degrees. So that means when the hand is resting on the top dead center of the hand rim, your elbow is 120 degrees. Similar position, similar minima for co-contraction moment at the shoulder, and similar minimum for normalized metabolic cost. So this seems to be an optimal place to put the hand rim. So this is basically what it would look like. That's where the wheel should be in sort of the optimally placed wheelchair. But of course, if you did that, the wheelchair would tip over backwards. So really our approach to this is quite simple, is that we just separate the hand rim from the drive wheel and connect them with the chain. So, you know, one of the visitors in our lab, he said, oh, it's very much like the bicycle. So the bicycle in the old days was one big wheel, and you jumped up on this seat, and you pedaled directly the big drive wheel. And then at some point, someone said, hey, let's disconnect these things and connect with a chain. And then we can do things like gearing and so forth. So we had some initial prototypes that were pretty rough and nasty looking. This is one pretty wide design. We had three veterans try this design, really just looking at a forward and backward position of the hand rim. And also what's unique about the chair too is you can take the hand rim off completely for transfer, so it's completely out of the way. And so we wanted to get some quantitative feedback. This gives you an idea, you know, basically you don't reach back as far as you can imagine when it's forward than when it's back. And the thing you'd immediately think of is sort of shoulder flexion, you know, is the shoulder is less extended, right, when it's forward. But the other thing is abduction. So actually when you reach back further, your shoulders abduct more as well. And that's sort of, that sort of pinches this area, which is not good. So the rotator cuff starts to get pinched. So in listening to what the veterans said, lateral distance is too wide. You can see this in the picture. So just the width of the wheelchair there, we're abducting his shoulders and putting it too wide. Drive wheels are too far back in this particular design, so you couldn't do wheelies. You could use, but one person said, hey, you could use a second push rim if you wanted to. And then you could sort of switch gears by just grabbing the other push rim, right? So get going with the big push rim and then go to the smaller one. It'd be a way to sort of shift gears. And of course, the comment you love to hear is, hey, it feels like I'm not using my shoulders, when they were in the anterior position. So they were perceiving this to be easier on the shoulders. So this is our second prototype, and now our drive wheels are further forward. It's narrower, as you can see on the right. And we have this sort of quick attach system to get the hand rim out of the way. So what's neat about the quick attach system, it's the same system you use on a race car to take the steering wheel off a race car. Sort of a spline shaft deal. we have a movie here of a veteran with spinal cord injury trying the wheelchair. So this version, we had the two hand rims, but they're actually so close together that you basically just grabbed both of the hand rims as you went. You can see the maneuverability is still there. He's able to do wheelies and turn around. I can't do this in any wheelchair. He's now showing how the hand rim easily comes off and put it back on. And that allows you to get right next to the transfer surface, set the brakes, and then now there's basically no wheel, no hand rim at all in your way to do this direct lateral transfer. It's a bit of a hard transfer because there's different levels there too. But well, another neat thing that we found is, you know, usual wheelchair, your hands are so close to the wheels that your hands are continuously dirty, wet. You know, in Minneapolis, they get snowy. Because the wheels on ours, you sort of tuck them underneath, your hands will stay clean. So we think that actually be a huge deal, potentially in hospital settings. So we now have a proposal pending to develop ergonomic wheelchairs specifically for seniors. And one reason I've sort of got very interested in senior wheelchair users is the VA wanted to show this movie on their national blog site. And so they posted the movie. And the next day I had 5 phone calls. I think 4 out of 5 were senior, older veterans. Like, hey, I'm 85 years old. I think that thing would be great. I could get around, you know, or family members of elderly wheelchair users. So, you know, in that case, the senior wheelchair user, we usually put the wheel and the hand rim quite far back because tipping over backward is something you really want to avoid. So that's also, you know, that's so you're in playing that sort of game, you want to err toward stability in those wheelchair users. So we think this wheelchair could be highly useful. You can gear it up or down, and we think it should improve mobility and independence, which we think would promote improved participation. So this came up as we were working on
this. In 4, Cassie Mitchell of the USA in 5, and Kerry Morgan of the USA in 6. And away they go. Kiyama away, Stillwell's away the best. Mitchell, it's Stillwell against Mitchell, and Morgan very slow in getting going. Stillwell flying down here. It's Stillwell for Canada, absolutely flying. Guys just standing up in the way, so I can't see what's happening. Stillwell's come through. Then it's Mitchell, then it's Morgan. Morgan very, very slow indeed. So it's an easy win for Michelle Stillwell of Canada, Cassie Mitchell.
So as you notice there, they're pushing on a small hand rim, and initially, of course, it's hard to get going, and then they're pushing, the wheels are going really fast, so it doesn't seem like they're getting a huge push on each cycle. So of course, Dr. Goldish said we should create a wheelchair where we could gear it so you can actually go faster. And so we're considering doing this as a sort of publicity stunt and probably getting thrown out of the event, but just to show what you can do with sort of these chain-driven wheelchairs. So we have also worked on standing wheelchair designs and primarily trying to give mobility in the standing position. So there's a number of standing frames on the market for persons with spinal cord injury. And there's a lot of benefits of standing. So the one that I think is probably not, people don't argue about, is that you've reduced pressure on the sitting surface by standing. So not too many people would argue that. There are other perceived benefits in terms of bone health, reduced contractures, range of motion, things like that, as well as other things that are don't have as much evidence, but that a lot of people believe in. So there are also some standing wheelchairs on the market. There is a manual standing wheelchair shown on the left This invention is about as old as I am, so I think it's 1974, 1973, something like that, when this was invented. Once you stand up, though, you go nowhere. So you're standing still. So you can stand, but you can't go anywhere. And if you want to move, you sit down, you move, and then you stand up again. There are also powered wheelchairs, and some standing powered wheelchairs allow you to move around in the standing position. But they're much larger, heavier, very expensive, etc. So what really was missing was sort of a manual standing wheelchair where you could stand up and move around. So this is one of the first things I started working with Gary Goldish on. And we ended up, get rid of the piano music here. We ended up coming up with this design. Also, chain-driven wheelchair. It basically has two chains per side. So you can see that also independent push rims and drive wheels. In fact, we started working on this wheelchair first, and then we said, why aren't we doing this in other wheelchairs? But you can see you can get around while seated, and then you can stand up using the wheelchair's function. You know, already had this feature. But the new thing is that the hand rims come up with you, and now you're able to get around while you're standing. So it was an interesting project. We had a visitor at our lab, and she said, can I take a picture of your wheelchair? And we said, sure, go ahead and take it. But I didn't realize she's taking a movie. So she was taking a movie of the wheelchair. She posted it on her Facebook page, and that movie sort of went viral. And it's so you may have seen a movie about this. 21 million people saw this movie, so I'm not sure. But basically, we're now working on improving this design. It should be done in about a week, in fact. And this was funded by Paralyzed Veterans of America. So a lot of things we were concerned about. So a lot of things were the stability of the chair. So when you're standing, is this thing going to easily tip over? So we did some tests in a motion lab. This is a instrumented treadmill, so we could actually measure, you know, where's the center of pressure under the wheelchair with respect to the base of support. So you could see, with sitting, I was moving forward side to side, and that's how you're getting this T shape. And then in standing, I was doing the same thing, leaning forward side to side. You can see we're well within the base of support. Okay, but this. You know, there's other things we need to look at as well, so like dynamic stability. This is one of the engineers that worked on this design, and this is something that a crazy engineer will do if he really believes in his design. So he really studied this a lot and believed that wouldn't fall over. We prefer that we would wear a helmet if he does this. I'm not 100% sure it will always work, but basically, he shows this is very stable in the standing position. And so now we're working pretty closely with a standing wheelchair company to improve this, make it narrower, make it more commercially viable. This is showing sort of concealing the chains, making it narrower. One of the key things with our design is the drive wheel. You always have a lot of load on the drive wheel. So when you're sitting, there's sort of your center of pressure pretty close to the drive wheel, and it's really sort of a front wheel drive chair. And when you go to standing, load moves instead ahead of the drive wheel, and now it becomes a rear wheel drive chair. So there's a couple casters in the front, a couple in the back. And again, you know, the Sloak and Neptune study is great because it can guide where do we want the hand rim to end up. So we basically want the hand rim to end up in these biomechanically optimal positions. And on the left, the idea is for this, you know, we could remove the hand rim, or maybe we could just drop it down enough so it's out of the way for transfers. So in conclusion on this project, mobility and standing may increase time in standing, which relieves pressure on the sitting tissues and can reduce pressure injuries. Now, the standing posture also allows the user to reach more items off the shelf. So if you're at the grocery store, you can get something by yourself. It's off the top shelf. You don't need to ask for help. And standing mobility can allow participation in other fun events. So CBS came and did a story on our wheelchair, and we were in a room that had a basketball hoop. And so the reporter played a little bit of basketball with the veteran using the wheelchair. And so the first time in a long time that he shot a basketball from the standing position. And of course, Dr. Goldish, next time they come back for a story, wants him to do a layup instead to really feature the mobility approach. So I want to go back to this. So oftentimes people who use wheelchair may get a pressure injury to the sitting tissues. And this can take them really out of their life for a while. You have to sometimes get a surgery to repair this. And at our facility, if you get this surgery, there's 6 weeks of bed rest while this heals. Because without that, there's sort of a high failure rate. If you start moving too quickly, the surgical site can be hurt. So we wanted to give people something to do during this 6 weeks after these surgeries. So we developed this supine arm cycle ergometer. And so this basically covers what I just said. It can be a long process of rehab after these surgeries. Before I arrived there, Gary Goldish had already made a couple of different designs. One was a pretty simple pedal exerciser. And the real problem is this whole thing moves a lot. So it wasn't stable. You have to throw sandbags on it. And they still used it, but it really didn't work well. They had a second device, which you see on the right, which is an arm cycle ergometer on a table, which is what people normally do in a seated position with this device. But you can see here, and it's hard to reach that. The table's actually in the way of your arms, and you can't see the monitor at all. And we were in the room looking at this, and I said, basically all this stuff just needs to be rotated so you can see all this. And then he was getting a little nervous with me, holding this pretty heavy thing over his head. So we thought, this obviously is not the answer. You can't have somebody standing there. So we developed this third prototype, and it was pieced together really from a patient lift and an exercise bike, and then some parts in between. And so we created a bunch of this stuff here to basically run the flywheel, use the same resistance mechanism that was already in the bike, and then also use the same monitor so people could see how much exercise they're doing. We did two tests. We did an initial study using four veterans with spinal cord injury who were outpatients, had no current medical issues. We had them come in, use the bike, and the primary thing we were looking at is what are the pressures like under their sitting tissues. Is there a lot of pressure, fluctuations as they cycle? And we wanted to compare that with seated arm ergometry. And then we've since then been doing a pilot study of veterans with SCI after this flap procedure, so they can use this bike, and really getting feedback on the design itself, and also what things would sort of motivate them to use it. So these are results from the kind of outpatient study part, and basically the pressures under your seated tissues, as you might imagine, are much less when you're lying down than when you're seated. So that's what sort of the blue versus the red. And at the bottom, we really showed that if you go at a high resistance, lower RPM, you can actually get a good workout. So the green dot is saying, hey, you're getting a moderate exercise, and this is only 5 minutes, so keep going 15, 20, 30 minutes, should get better. And the pressure fluctuations were very low. So this is an example of if you're pedaling too fast. Okay, so you can sort of see The hips moving all around here. So he's pedaling pretty fast. So it's better to sort of go slower, high resistance. And then recently we've added a gaming feature that's an off-the-shelf thing that we've coupled with this to make it easier. We've also shown this can work in an air fluidized bed. And when you do pressure mapping there, it's very low pressure. It's very, very well distributed by the bed itself. And I've blocked off the face here, but if that little black box is missing, you'd see a big smile on this guy's face because he's been laying there for 14 days doing nothing. So to do this, which is something, is much more fun. So we're trying to get funding to really study this in this population. And we're not talking about a large number of people, but it's a really significant thing, I think. This is the gaming system that we used. And really so far with the inpatients, all the patients who are on sitting restrictions really continue to use the device. When they sort of get off of the sitting restrictions, they might go to the gym instead. With the game, one guy played every game he could play with that system. Sometimes worked out longer than they told him to work out because he wanted to finish the level of the game. And so in another wife of a patient said, that machine was really a ray of sunshine for this guy. I have the pictures to prove it to you. So all these things are highly motivating to move forward and get this thing on the market so people can actually use it. And then we've really sort of saturated, I think, the feedback in terms of what people want with the device. They want it to be less wobbly during cycling, and they want larger cycling resistances. So we're working on that right now with this system here, which would have more of a four-bar linkage. This is much more similar to sort of like the basketball hoops that you can just push a little lever and easily move them up or down. Same system will be used in this machine. And so then you don't need this motor, you don't need the battery to plug that in and things like that. So that was a big feedback we received from veterans using this. Hey, make sure with the next bike you actually make this in phase, because we want to train for hand cycling when we get out of here, right? So that was important. So we're putting that feature in the next design as well. Last thing I'll breeze through real quick because I'm basically out of time, but there's this thing called dropped head syndrome. It's very common. It's somewhat common in patients with ALS, a certain type of ALS, where you start to lose control of the neck muscles, and you end up with fatigue and sort of the head resting on the chest. There are several ways to try to take care of this. Almost all of them work by holding the chin in some way, but really that's uncomfortable. Doesn't allow you to tuck your chin for swallowing. It can make it difficult to talk or eat. And sometimes restricts head motion. This is an interesting device where it's not working on the chin. It's working on the forehead, holding the head back to a wheelchair. But a lot of ALS patients in that stage can still walk. So they don't want to be connected to a wheelchair. And so we tried to take the best of these two devices and came up with this. It has sports because it has a baseball cap, right? So basically a baseball cap and a strap from the cap to the pants with some suspenders. So really low tech. So the history of this project is pretty funny because we were bending metal and all these massive contraptions. And then we realized all we need is this little resistance back here. It's all we really need. So I would say this work, we did a small study of 7 veterans with ALS. About half of them loved it. The other half of them hated it. But I think, you know, it's a good alternative, something to use with the chin supports. And this really sort of shows our approach. We really like this cartoon. We don't really want to be high tech. We don't want to be low tech, but we really want to find the right tech. And that's, of course, sometimes easier said than done. But this is what we're always striving for. Try to find the right level of technology to answer the, solve the problem. So with that, I'll close, and if we have time for questions, I'll take those. Thank you.
Questions? Any questions?
Going back to your design for the foot design and the ankle, do you find that you had to have a difference if you had a single or a double amputee in terms of the design?
Yeah, so that's something we haven't really looked at too closely. But my guess is that the bimodal ankle, for example, would be even more useful for bilateral amputees because they're currently using 2 feet that are both designed for walking and that have flexibility. Whereas with someone with unilateral amputation, even if you have sort of a flat base and even a peg leg, you could still be stable, although not ideal. But so I think that's a population we want to study in the future as well, bilateral amputees. Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.